وقل رب زدني علما.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد على آله وصحبه أجمعين. أهلا وسهلا ومرحبا. I welcome everybody back to this course, the Quran reading course, after a long break. And inshallah ta'ala, today we are going to start with module 3. Today we're going to start with module 3. And module 3, to be honest, it's theoretically, or in terms of the new theory that we learn, it's very straightforward. It's very easy. And there's not so much to be covered. Out of the three modules, module 2 is the most challenging. Right now, when it comes to module 3, it's really about a few rules that are related to how to connect the words. So module 1 was about the Arabic letters. Module 2 was about the Arabic vowels. Module 2 was about the Arabic vowels. And today, inshallah ta'ala, continue with module 3, it's about Arabic sentences. So sorry, module 1 is Arabic letters. Module 2 is about the word on the word level. Now we're on the sentence level. So all of you know how to read, inshallah, every word in the Arabic language separately by itself. But these words, when they're joined together, when you make sentences, when you read the whole ayah, there are certain rules that you need to be aware of. Okay? One of the rules we've already covered, which is al-ibtida, when you start reciting. We talked about hamzatul wasl. And even though al-ibtida was initially part of module 3, we brought it forward to module 2 because of its connection to hamzatul wasl. And hamzatul wasl is a diacritic that is to be found on some of the words. So today, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to talk about the topic of al-waqf. Al-waqf. Al-waqf is the opposite of al-ibtida. Al-ibtida means to start or resume, whereas al-waqf means to pause or stop. Okay? So when you're reciting the Quran and you want to stop because you got to the end of the ayah, for example, or you want to stop because you want to take a breath, then there are certain rules you need to be aware of. Okay? And those are the ones we're going to be talking about today. طيب. So inshallah, going forward, I think Allah knows best. Maybe one or two more lectures and we should be done with the course, inshallah. And then beyond that, it's all about practicing. It's all about practicing. So we can set up maybe, we can arrange some kind of practice session or certain workshops can continue so that all of you can progress really towards reading the Quran by yourself. Because when we finish this course, my dear brothers and sisters, even though you'll know the theory behind how to read, you're still going to need to implement everything you've learned. You're still going to need to practice on a daily basis. And some of you that have studied with me, maybe in the previous cohort, you know what I mean. As in, the end of this course is just the start. In reality, the end of this course is that's where your journey starts with the Quran, whereby you start reading on a daily basis. So the idea, inshallah, is that maybe we set up some kind of daily reading sessions or something on Telegram where you can practice regular basis. Inshallah, that's something we'll discuss later. طيب, before we start, let's ask a question on WooClap. Okay? Just to see if any of you have background knowledge when it comes to Waqf and Ibtida. Okay? So, there are a few letters that we've learned so far when it comes to letter recognition. There are certain letters that we've said we will explain why they look like this towards the end of the course. This really now where these letters, they become relevant. Okay? So, which letters do you think are affected by stopping on them? Okay, this is a very general question. It's more of a revision question, to be honest, for those of you that studied here before or studied with me before. So there are certain letters that we've learned so far that are affected or that change depending on if we stop on them or not. Okay? So these letters, if you like, they look a certain way, but they're pronounced in a different way. Okay? They're kind of like anomalies that we've come across so far when we were learning or when we were doing letter recognition. Okay. Which letters are they? Can you remember? So we have a list of answers here. Jim. Some of you said ha, hamza, dal, ba, and qaf. Okay, so this one is the correct one. Ta marbuta. You see ta marbuta? Ta marbuta, we said it's a bit, remember we mentioned that ta marbuta is kind of like awkward because of the way it looks and what we actually say. It looks like a ha, or we pronounce a ta. Can you remember that? That's something that's related to today's lesson. Okay, ta marbuta. Okay. طيب, so that was just a quick way of trying to remember things. طيب. So we have what we call طيب, bismillah. We have what we call waqf, which is pausing and stopping. Last lesson we talked about ibtida, which is starting or resuming. Okay. When it comes to waqf and ibtida, let's start off with an example, like always, this surah, okay? Or these two ayat that most of you are familiar with. Wal asr, a'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Wal asr, innal insana lafi khusr. Okay? That's how it's read. So I repeat, wal asr, innal insana lafi khusr. Okay, طيب. So you should notice something here. By the way, I'm reading this. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر. So what you notice here is that this ra over here has a kasra. Okay, and this ra over here has two kasras. Okay, now what did I do? Let's pose that question and we'll clap. Okay, so what is it? What have I done? Yani, in other words, how did I pronounce it? Okay, so wal asr, innal insana lafi khusr. What did I do there? Okay, so if you focus on these two ras here that are underlined, okay, what do you notice? That's the subject of today's class. Okay, so some of you said in Wuklab, you pronounced Ra with Sukun. Used Sukun to stop. Didn't pronounce the Tanween or the Kasra because you stopped. You didn't pronounce them at all. You only pronounced the letter as if they were Sukun on them instead of the vowel. You have not pronounced the Haraka on the end letter. You pronounced both of them the same way. Okay, you left off the kasra sound. You pronounced the last letter with the sukun. Na'am, all these answers are correct. Okay, so what I did is, I pronounced the last letter with a sukun. Or you can say, I didn't pronounce the kasra. Or you can say, I didn't pronounce the tanween. Which, because they're both ras as well, I pronounced both of them the same way. Wal asr, innal insana lafi khusr. Okay. That's the rule basically. When it comes to waqf and ibtida, this is one of the rules. This is the number one rule. This is what? The number one rule. Okay? So, this is what we call the general waqf. General waqf is going to be upon sukun. Okay? General waqf, generally speaking, when we talk about waqf, when we talk about stopping, when we talk about pausing, the last letter is going to have a sukun. For example, Surah Al-Fatiha. What do we say? الحمد لله رب العالمين نون at the end. We don't say الحمد لله رب العالمين. We don't say na at the end, even though that noon is a fatha. We don't say الرحمن الرحيم. No, we say الرحمن الرحيم. We stop on his sukun. This is what we call general waqf. Anytime you stop on a sukun. As in the last vowel, you don't pronounce it. So why is that vowel there? That vowel is there in case you don't stop. In case you continue, you pronounce it. So this would be wal asri innal insana lafi khusrin illa alladhina. That's if I want to continue. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين. That's if you want to continue. If you want to continue, you pronounce everything that's there. You want to stop, you stop on his sukun. Okay. Here we have another type or another rule when it comes to waqf. And that's something we notice here at the end. So let me pronounce it and then tell me what I did. Okay. So this would be وَالْعَادِيَاتِ ضَبَحَا. I repeat. وَالْعَادِيَاتِ ضَبَحَا. What did I do? Okay, so let's pose that question again. On Wuklab, the exact same question. What have I done? What did I pronounce? وَالْعَادِيَاتِ ضَبَحَا. What did I pronounce? Okay. As opposed to what's written. What's written is وَالْعَادِيَاتِ ضَبَحًا. That's what's written. But what do we pronounce, especially when we stop there at the end of the ayah? وَالْعَادِيَاتِ ضَبَحًا فَالْمُورِيَاتِ قَدَحًا فَالْمُغِيرَاتِ صُبَحًا. Okay. What are we doing here? Okay. Someone said مَد. Someone said سُكُون. Someone said fatha in place of a tanween. Fatha in place of a tanween. Someone said didn't pronounce the tanween. Okay. All right. You only pronounce the harak if you continue. Pronounced a fatha without or instead of tanween. Okay. So basically what we did here is, and this will clarify something that we said we will cover towards the end when we learn tanween. Remember when we did tanween, there was an extra alif with the fathatan or fathatain that was not there for the two kasras and the two dhammas. And we said we'll talk about that later. This is here now. Now you'll know why the alif is there. What we basically did is we didn't pronounce the tanween. Okay? But we kept the fatha. So it's not like this one over here. Innal insana lafi khusr. But we got rid of the kasra and the tanween together. La, this one is a bit different. Here we just got rid of the nunation, we got rid of the tanween, we got rid of the extra noon, we got rid of the noon with sukun. Okay? But we keep the fatha. Why do we keep the fatha? So that the alif can elongate the fatha. It can stretch. Okay. So we have the here we have it. وَالْعَادِيَاتِ ضَبْحًا. What did we do? We kept the fatha. We got rid of the tanween. And then now the alif comes in handy. This alif over here, now it comes into use. What does it do? It stretches the fatha. So it becomes وَالْعَادِيَاتِ ضَبْحًا with a med. Okay? If we were to continue, then the alif would have no job. وَالْعَادِيَاتِ ضَبَحًا فَالْمُورِيَاتِ قَدَحًا. We'll be pronouncing the tanween normally. Okay? And the alif would have no use. But this alif is there on standby. It's kind of like Hamzatul Wasl. Remember the way that we said Hamzatul Wasl is there on standby, just waiting for you to start on it? Same thing here. The alif is just waiting for you to stop on the fatha. When you do, alif comes into play, it stretches the fatha. Okay, and you have many surahs in the Quran that end with fathatain at the end. Sometimes whole surahs. Yani Surah Amma, for example, towards the end ends with fathatain. والنازعات غرقا, same thing, ends with fathatain, every single ayah. Okay, then we have والعاديات as well. Most of the ayat end with two fathas. And you even have some big surahs like Surah An-Nisa. Okay, apart from one ayah, if I'm not mistaken, every single ayah ends with two fathas. Yani tanween. Which means that when you end or you stop on it, you always end with an a at the end. Surah al-Jinn as well. Inna uhiya, what's it called? Surah al-Qul uhiya ilayya, annahu istama'a nafaru min al-jinni faqalu inna sami'na qur'anan ajaba. And it ends like that, okay? So all of these ayat, they end with two fathas. Which ends up becoming a med. if we stop at the end of the ayah. And sometimes same thing applies within the middle of the ayah. It doesn't have to be at the end. Sometimes halfway through the ayah, if you decide to stop, you decide to pause, you stretch the fatha. You stretch the short vowel, you make a long vowel, and you make use of the alif. Okay? Tayyib. All right. So that's the second rule now that we've learned so far. So we have the general waqf. Then we have waqf on two fathas. Whenever we stop on two fathas, what do? We elongate the fatha. Now we have the third type of waqf. Okay. So again, I'm going to pronounce it and then you tell me what's happening. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. Okay, so we pay attention, obviously. We pay attention to the last letter because that's where we stop. I stopped at the end of the ayah. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. What did I do here? Again, let's ask that question on Wuklab. Okay, so try and put that in words. What happened here? How would you explain that to someone? Okay. What happened here? How did we stop? Okay. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. What happened here? How should it be? And what did we actually end up doing? Okay, let's see some of the answers. Ta marbuta, pronounced as ha, ended with a ha. Ta is pronounced as a ha. You pronounce the za with sukun. And I think you mean the ta. Ended with ha. You change the sound of ta, or ta marbuta, from ta to pronouncing it as a ha. Na'am, exactly. So that's basically what happened. So now the question is, does it make sense now why ta marbuta looks like an ha, but is pronounced like a ta? It has been pronounced like a ta so far because we haven't learned this rule yet, the rule of waqf, stopping. So far, whenever we came across ta marbuta, we have been pronouncing the ta, just like this word over here. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ هُمَزَةٍ. Can you see that? Tin. Humazatin. Tin. Hey, we didn't say humazahin. No. We're pronouncing the ta. We're saying humazatin. Okay? That's clear, isn't it? But then when we come to this ta over here, we pronounce it ha. Lumazah. We don't say lumazatin. We don't say lumazat. Okay? And some people, they some of the languages that use some of the Arabic words, they do this. They pronounce the tamar buta in their language. So instead of ni'mah, they say ni'mat. Instead of rahmah, they say rahmat. Yes? Because obviously their language doesn't have tamar buta. So either the ta is there or it isn't. Sah? So you have some languages, they say rahmat, they say ni'mat. But in Arabic, la. In Arabic, if you're going to say the word by itself, is ni'mah, rahmah. And this tamar buta is also known, or is used a lot for female names. And it's actually one of the signs of an object or a name being a female name. It's not a definite sign, but it's one of the markers, one of the signs. So for example, you have Aisha, Fatima. All of these words end with a ta marbuta. Okay? So if we were to say the word Aisha in a sentence and not stop on it, we would say قالت عائشة رضي الله عنها. قالت عائشة رضي الله عنها. We say two at the end. عائشة. We don't say in Arabic قالت عائشة رضي الله عنها. لا. Some people they say it like that lahja wise, but the correct way or the fusha way would be to say قالت عائشة رضي الله عنها. Okay. However, if we stop on the name عائشة, we would say عائشة. We would stop like that. هذه عائشة. We would stop like that. هذه فاطمة. Would stop like that. If we continue, هذه فاطمة بنت رسول الله. هذه فاطمة بنت رسول الله. Okay. طيب. Or هذه فاطمة بنت رسول الله. هذه فاطمة بنت رسول الله. That's how we would say it. Okay. Mumtaz. So this is what we call stopping on ta marbuta. This is what we call stopping on ta marbuta. Waqf on ta marbuta. Okay. طيب, which again we said you pronounce a ha. So these were the examples. Okay. And to give you a summary of the rulings, then it would be like, it would be as follows. Okay. You would have, if you continue, what do we do? And if you pause, what do you do? Okay. So if you want, before we give you the answer, we can put that as a question on WooClap. So let's say we'll make it an open question. When we continue, or let's say when we continue generally, okay? We, okay, so you're going to have an empty space there. Okay, you fill out the blank, okay? That's one way. Let's pose that question first and we'll go to the next one. So when we continue, generally, what do we do? You can answer on WooClap. When we continue, generally, what do we do? As opposed to when we stop? Generally speaking, before we speak about the specific rules. Generally speaking, what do we do when we continue? And what do we do when we stop? Okay, we generally pronounce the haraka. Okay, recite it as per the diacritic. Now, pronounce it as Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu, written without stopping at the end. Now, pronounce whatever vowel is at the end. Yes, okay? We pronounce the tanween, we pronounce the haraka, we pronounce everything the way it's written, the way we've known so far. Okay, why? Because the waqf rules are related to when we stop. So when we continue, we'll continue the way we're used to continuing, which is reading everything the way it shows. Okay? So that's generally speaking when we continue. Okay? Now the question that follows up from that is, when we continue, when we stop, okay, generally, what do? Okay, so that's when we continue. Here we say when we stop. Okay, let's make that capital. Okay, when we stop or pause. When we stop or pause. Generally, what do we do? Generally speaking, what do we do? Generally speaking, we end with a sukun. Now, we put a sukun. Or we stop on a sukun. Which means we don't read the haraka or the tanween. Okay, so we are generally speaking, when we stop on the sukun. Okay, that's perfect. That's the answer to the first line. So the first line, what do we have? General waqf upon sukun. We continue. We pronounce the vowels or the tanween, whatever is there. Okay. When we pause on the sukun. We pause or stop on the sukun. Okay, let's go on to the waqf when it comes to fathatan. Okay, so when we do waqf on fathatan, what do we do? Okay, when we do waqf on fathatan, what do we do? So we know what we do when we continue. When we continue to pronounce the fathatan, so we're not going to ask that question again. Generally, when we continue, applies to all three situations. We pronounce what's there. But when we do for waqf, what do we do? When we do waqf on fathatan, what do? We recite as med, we elongate. Na'am, we make a med with the alif at the end. Yes. Stretch it or pronounce as med. Pronounce the haraka and the tamin. Okay. Again, please pay attention. This is only for fathatan, two fathas. Don't do the same when it comes to two kasras or two dhammas. Because the two kasras don't come with a ya, and the two dhammas, they don't come with a waw. Only the two fathas are come with an alif. So we elongate, we recite as med. So when you say we recite as med, we elongate, i.e. the fathatan, only when we have fatha, not when we have kasratan or dhammatan. Okay. Perfect. That's good. So again, waqfan fathatan, what do? We continue, we pronounce the two fathas. We pause on aliful mad. As in this alif, we use it as a mad to elongate the fatha. Wal-'adiyati dhabha. All right. Final question would be, when we do waqf on ta marbuta, what do we do? When we do waqf on ta marbuta, what do we do? Okay. All right, change it to a ha. Recite it as a ha. Pronounce it as a ha. Now, so we don't change it to a, we don't change anything here. It already looks like a ha anyway. So we pronounce it as a ha. Okay? Okay, we don't change the tamarbuta to ha. When you say change, sounds like we're actually changing something when we're not. We're just pronouncing a different version. Okay? Sometimes we pronounce tamarbuta as a ta. Sometimes we pronounce it as a ha. That's why it's a ta that looks like a ha. Okay? Tayyib. So that's what it is then. When it comes to waqf on ta marbuta, we continue, we pronounce a ta. We pause, we pronounce a ha. Okay. So now, does that make sense? I think now so many things, a lot of things that didn't make sense before, now it does. And also this points out, or this clarifies, the sophisticated nature of the Arabic script. And it's amazing the way they thought through everything. Allahumma barik. Okay? So yes, the Arabic script, or the Quranic script, to be more precise, it's mashallah, it's very precise. Alhamdulillah. And that explains why fathatan always come with an alif. It also explains why ta marbuta looks like a ha. Okay? In those cases, will alif always be there? Yes. If there's two fathas, there's an alif there. Always. Always. Apart from a few exceptions, which you don't need to worry about at this stage. Okay? How do we stop on the tanween kasra and dhamma? How do we stop on it? We stop on a sukun. That's the default. So the ta marbuta and the fathatan are two exceptions to the rule. They're two exceptions to the rule. Everything else, you get rid of the kasra, you get rid of the tanween. That's why if we go back to the video and we check the end, right at the end, let me show you again. That should answer that question. What did we say? Continue, you pronounce the vowels and the tanween. You pronounce the vowels or the tanween. So if he has a vowel, you say wal asri. If he has tanween, you say khusrin. Same thing applies to Dhamma. If it's Dhamma, you say U at the end. If it's Dhammatan, you say Un. Okay? That's what we do. Okay? If we pause, it's a Sukun. So that would answer your question. What do we do with two Kasras, two Dhammas? We stop on a Sukun. We don't pronounce it. Tayyib. Any other questions? Okay. طيب. طبعا today I know that we started a little bit late, so I apologize for that. What's it called? When it comes to practice, inshallah, we'll continue practice reading inshallah on Saturday during the workshop. We can do some practice on this, but inshallah we'll leave practice for Saturday inshallah. Right now what we'll do is with regards to the exam. Okay, so alhamdulillah I've got 23 of you attending, mashallah. Of course, we don't have the same numbers as we had when we started, and you know, with the long break and some of you struggling with med and these sort of things, I can imagine that some of you have fallen behind. So I'm going to present you with two options, inshallah ta'ala. The first option is I can send the exam or prepare it for this, what we've done so far, that wouldn't include waqf. Okay. Or we can just have probably one more lecture. So one more workshop on Saturday. Tuesday, I have another lecture on what we call the golden rule in Arabic. And this is a rule that applies to everything so far. I call it the golden rule. It's pretty easy, inshallah ta'ala. Don't be worried, but it's quite important. And then beyond that, we'll be done with the curriculum or the theory side of things. There is one more thing that we can add to that, which is the Waqf signs, which is the signs within the Mus'haf that tell you or show you where you can stop and where you shouldn't stop. But this is also, I suppose, is more related to tajweed and tafsir than actual Quran reading. But we can also teach that as well. It's not a big deal. It's pretty straightforward. It's not difficult. Okay? So within the Quran, you have certain signs that tell you where you're allowed to stop, where you should stop, where you shouldn't stop, and these sort of things. These are called the Waqf signs. We can cover them as well. Ma fi mushkila. Okay, so that would, in total, it wouldn't be more than two lectures. So what we can do is, we can have those two lectures, and then just have one exam that includes everything. And then khalas, anybody that does the exam, that passes the exam, would get the certificate, inshallah. And then beyond that, we would look at how we can set up some kind of regular practice sessions, you know, to just implement everything. So it might be something like, the idea that I have, if you have any ideas, feel free to put it forward. I was thinking of maybe a Telegram channel where I send half a page every day to start off with, and then everybody just reads the half a page, and then they can just voice record it, for example. And then some of them I would maybe check, some of them the students would check among themselves. But with kind of the purpose of that Telegram channel would be just to send a daily portion to be read from the Quran. We would start with half a page, and then as we get more fluent, we might increase it to a page. And you never know, if we are regular, then mashallah, yani maybe before Ramadan, we can maybe finish a third of the Quran or half of the Quran, or maybe some of you even the whole Quran. Yani it depends, yes, on your level and how you progress. So that would be the intention. So we've explained everything. Now let's just practice. So I would basically just share half a page or one page from the Quran every day in a Telegram group. One for the brothers, one for the sisters, and then everyone would just, as homework, or to be sure to practice on a daily basis, just record that part, and then students would give each other feedback, or maybe we can get other volunteers on the channel, on the group, to also check the recordings and give feedback, and then you would progress like that. So that's obviously after we graduate or after you get the certificate, for those of you that get to that level, inshallah. And some of you, I don't know if some of you that are attending now is the case for them, or maybe some of you that will watch this video later. I know that some have fallen off track and, you know, that need to start back up. An option there is to start from the beginning of module 2 instead of beginning of module 1. But again, that's something that, based on the surveys that I've sent out on Telegram, I'm going to take in the information, and then based on that, we'll see how best to progress. If to give some support lessons to bring up those that are almost there, but they just need an extra push, or to just finish this course off and then just relaunch it again and start from module 1, and then everyone that fell off track can start over again from module 1. Again, something that we'll look into. But when it comes to the exam, like I said, either we can do a quick exam and then it's going to be another exam again 2 weeks later, or we can just hold out, wait for one more week until next Tuesday, have the last lecture next Tuesday or latest next Saturday, and then do maybe another revision session, a workshop, and then mashallah, we can do the exam in one go. Type. So let me know, inshallah, what you think. Yeah, I'm thinking as well, it's better to just hold out. Let me do a quick poll then on WooClap. Okay. So just going to put a quick poll on WooClap, inshallah. What option shall we go for? Do one exam now and another at the end. Wait and do one final exam. Okay, hope you understand. moment. Okay. What options are we go for? Okay, overwhelmingly, almost everyone wants to wait and do one final exam. طيب. Yeah, it seems like that the vast majority would rather wait and do one final exam, which I lean towards as well, inshallah ta'ala. Again, it doesn't mean, for those of you that want to do one exam now, one at the end, you know, the final exam, inshallah ta'ala, hopefully won't be too difficult. And, you know, if you find that after we do the final exam that you struggle, that you need some more time, more support, don't worry, inshallah. We can always do some extra support sessions and then you can resit the exam. So inshallah, resitting the exam is an option for those of you that struggle with the exam once we do it. Okay, so don't worry about that, inshallah. So bismillah al-kareem, the way things look, about 2 weeks from now, we'll be done with this course, inshallah ta'ala. And then, like we said, it will be the start. Okay, the end of this course will really be the start of your journey in reading the Quran, inshallah ta'ala. And inshallah, we will discuss on how hopefully I can be part of that journey bismillah after we finish this course. Allah yahfazkum. Okay, so the vast majority of you, like we said, 12 out of 15 wanted to wait and do one final exam. طيب, any other questions? One person said that I wish study start at 10. I would love to start at 10 as well. For Saudi time, it's 10:30 now, yeah. But I think it's a bit too late for those that are on my time zone. I don't know how many of you, but for me, it would be too late. 10 o'clock, we'd probably be finished by 11, 11:30, and that would be a bit too late for me. But having said that, I think very soon, when they change the hours, I'm going to be 3 hours ahead from those of you in the UK, which means 10:30 or 9:30 is going to be even earlier for you. Oh no, that sounds bad. I thought it was going to help us out. Bye. We'll see, inshallah. We'll see what we can do. Maybe just add a few more assignments to Google Classroom for practice. Okay, something I could look into. Inshallah, I'll do that. No problem. I'll add more assignments to Google Classroom. Definitely. Inshallah. I'll definitely do that, inshallah. Okay. Any other questions before we wrap up? Okay, if you have any other suggestions, inshallah, after the lesson ends, feel free to submit them on WorkLab, inshallah. Any other questions, feedback, suggestions, you can post them on WorkLab anytime, inshallah. Okay. That's a good idea, sending the daily reading to get feedback. Naam, inshallah. Hopefully it'll work out. Hopefully it'll work out, inshallah. Yes, 3 p.m. U.S. time would be Saudi time, 10 p.m. Yes. I mean, really, I don't think I can keep up with the U.S. time. Allah musta'an. I try my best to keep up with the U.K. time, where I'm 2 hours ahead of, and soon 3 hours. But I think there's just too big of a discrepancy with the U.S. time that I can't even hope, or I can't even attempt to keep up with the US time. It's really difficult because 7 hours difference on weekdays is basically it's impossible. So even 3 p.m. US time would be 10 p.m. Saudi time, which means we would finish at 11 p.m. Saudi time, would be too difficult, to be honest. So I really feel sorry for that. But that's why some of the classes, like the workshop and the tafsir class, we decided to make them on the weekend so that we don't have this problem. But any lessons that are going to be in the weekdays, then those of you that are joining us from the US, unless you're not working or not going to school, it's going to be difficult. Allah al-musta'an. Is the meaning of waqf related to the other meaning, endowment? Yes, it is. It is. Waqf means to stop. Okay. And endowment, when you do waqf on something, it means it is stopped on that activity only. So if I do a waqf and I say that this book is waqf lillahi ta'ala, it means it can only be used for that, and it can't be used for anything else. So if I say, for example, that this house, this block of apartments is waqf lillahi ta'ala for the students of knowledge, then that's the only thing that can be done. It can be given to students of knowledge to live there. So it's as if something which is free to be used for many different options or many different ways, when you do waqf, you're stopping it. And you're stopping it on just one thing. Okay? You're restricting it to just one thing, which is similar to waqf, which means to stop. Okay? Somebody asked, do we all have to do the exam the day you post it? I work shift, including weekends. No, you don't have to do exams normally. They're flexible. So you normally have like 24 hours, 48 hours, maybe even longer than that to do it. So it's not something that you have to do at a specific time. It's going to have a couple of days for you to attempt it, inshallah. Now, yes, the meeting has ended. The lesson is finished, inshallah. Feel free to do so. هذا والله عليه الصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته إن شاء الله look forward to seeing all of you on Saturday بارك الله فيكم